God is still speaking.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. In 2 days, on Tuesday, we celebrate Epiphany. And Epiphany is one of those celebrations, holidays, remembrances that we often sort of skip over, because we've had all the hype of Christmas, and then we go into New Year's, and then we're pretty much exhausted, and we go, okay, back to school, back to work, back to our regular routines, and we kind of just skip over Epiphany. Epiphany, though, is a really important part of the Christmas story, of our understanding of how God comes into the world and what God is trying to teach us and show us in the way that God came into the world. Epiphany falls 12 days after Christmas. The light goes on, right? The 12 days of Christmas, that's why that song is that, as opposed to 6 or 7 or 15. 12 days after Christmas. And it bookends, Christmas and Epiphany bookend the season of Christmastide, which is a time in which we are called to reflect on what God did on Christmas, some 2,000 plus years ago when Jesus was born, and what God is doing today in our lives. And what do these understandings of these stories teach us about that? Now, we have to pay attention to the stories because we've heard them quite often, and sometimes we just make assumptions about the people who are part of the stories and what they mean. It is important for us to remember that God comes into the world as an infant, just like everybody else. Not in some unique, special way, but born as a baby. But there's something significant to how that happens. Because Mary carries this child. And Mary is a plain old regular young girl. No different, really, than you or me, except she was probably younger than most people are, at least today, when they first become pregnant. Young girl. And her husband-to-be, Joseph, we understand to be a carpenter. So kind of regular folks. But they're regular folks, and they don't have a lot of money. More than likely, they're pretty poor or really poor. They have to make this journey from their home in Nazareth to Bethlehem, and there's no room for them at the inn, and it could be because the inn was all filled up, or it also could be because they just didn't have the money to get a room. Fortunately, they are able to find a stable, which the nativity set represents, and in that stable, they're able to find a manger, which is a feeding trough for the animals, where we put the hay and the grain and that kind of stuff. And out of that, they're able to fashion a bed in which, once their baby Jesus is born, they're able to place him. This is not how kings normally come into the world. This is not how powerful rulers normally come into the world. This is not how the elites of the world come into the world. And who witnesses that birth? Well, certainly his mother and his father, and perhaps a midwife, but also likely the animals who were usually got to stay in that stable and got displaced, at least for a while. And then an angel, we're told, goes and visits a shepherd who's out in the fields, up on the hills, sort of cast aside from the main of culture and society because, well, you know, if you spend weeks on end out in the countryside with animals, you tend not to smell very well. You tend also not to be usually some of the more educated of people. And so the angel of God comes to the shepherds and says, look, this miracle has happened. I want you to go to Bethlehem and to the stable and see it for yourself. So when the shepherds go. So they're the first witnesses to this miraculous birth. And so when we look at that story, when we step back, we have to recognize, we have to see that God comes into the world in the most regular and ordinary ways with the most regular and ordinary people. Perhaps even people that are looked down upon because they don't have the wealth or the status, prestige of others. This is how God chooses to come into the world. Now we flash forward a couple of years. Now I know that can seem a little tricky because in our desire to get through the stories as quickly as we can, we tend to put together the birth story and the story of the wise men or wise women or wise people of some combination or magi or kings or what's most likely astrologers, because they actually studied the stars in the sky. They noted when there was something different. We tend to put those two stories together, so we have, and we even have a little sort of vision of this here. We have the baby Jesus being born, and then the wise people show up and they bring their gifts. But more than likely, what happened was there was a period of time between the point in which Jesus was born and when these wise people show up. Probably about 2 years. And there's an unfortunate reason why we think that that's true. And we'll hear more about that in the story. But we have this miraculous birth, and then 2 years later, we have these wise people who come because they have seen a sign. They have seen the star in the sky. So let us listen to this account, to this story. Please let us listen for the word of God as it's found in the gospel according to Matthew, reading from the second chapter, verses 1 through 12. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we have observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and the scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet. And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. May God bless this reading from Holy Scripture. So we have these people, three, we guess, because there are three gifts mentioned. And they have come from the east somewhere, some far off land. They are people of a different culture. They are people, most likely, of a different faith. And yet, in their going about their lives, watching the stars, they've seen a new star in the sky, and in seeing that star, they think, this must be a symbol or an indication that a new king has been born to the Jewish people. Now, how they came to that conclusion, we don't know. They didn't write it down, or if they did, we haven't seen that record. But that's what they figured out. So they make this long journey, at least 2 years, we think. And they, thinking that the king has been born, they go where you would logically go to find a king in Jerusalem, because that's where the king lives. That's the big city. That's the capital city. That's where the palace is. And so you go to the palace looking for the new king, because that's where kings usually come into the world, right? They follow in the same line. There's that royal family stuff, and so one king begats another king, begats another king. You know, that's how it works. But they're surprised to find out there's no baby there. In fact, the people there, King Herod and the other folks, they've not even heard anything about this. Nothing. We don't know. But it upsets Herod. Not because maybe he missed something so important, but because if there has been a new king born, if the Messiah has come into the world, then that means his rule is threatened. That means he could be out of power before too long. So he's worried. So he brings those wise men, people in, come talk to me, talk to me. When did you see this star? And what we think is they said, well, it was probably about 2 years ago. Because when the wise people don't come back and tell Herod where they found Jesus, he orders the killing of all male children 2 years of age or under. Because he doesn't care. He just wants to get rid of that one potential baby. So they tell him 2 years. He asks his advisors. They say, well, if the Messiah is to be born, a new king to be born, it could be Bethlehem. You know, our scriptures say that that's where the new king could come from. Maybe that's where he is. And so the wise people say, thank you. And Herod says, now tell me when you find him, because I want to go and pay homage too. Right? And so off they go. And they see the star. And it settles over this house. Notice it's not the stable anymore. Jesus, Mary, and Joseph, they've moved to a house. Now, why they didn't go home, we don't know. You know, why didn't they leave Bethlehem and head back to Nazareth? We don't know. But anyway, so they're in a house. These wise people come in. They bring their gifts. And their gifts fit for the king. They must have thought it was pretty strange. Gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And I've read a story reflection over Christmas, you know, where Mary must have been like, great, but you know, what I really need? Like diapers. You know, or are you going to hang around for a few days so Joseph and I can get a little break here? Or, but that's what they bring. Gold, frankincense, and myrrh. There's a dream. God comes and speaks to them, don't go back to Herod. He doesn't want to do anything. It's nothing good that he's up to. So they head off another way. What this story seeks to get across to us is that God comes into the world, and there is a sign that this has happened up in the sky. And that sign is not limited to just the Jewish people, but rather it's up there for everyone to see. Because God comes into the world not just for one particular faith or one particular group of people. God comes into the world for everyone. And that's always how God has come into the world. That's always how God has acted. We just tend to always want to limit who God has showed up for. But that's not the reality. God comes into the world for everyone. And so that star's up in the sky, and these wise people from the east come to remind us of that. It doesn't matter. They're of a different culture and country. They practice a different way. It doesn't matter. They noticed. And they came to pay homage, to offer gifts, to try to make a connection. And that is God's desire. There is no limitation on who God wants to make connections with. And both of these stories, the bookends of this Christmastide season, tell us over and over and over again, look it, I'm coming into the world just like everybody else. As a child, I'm born to a poor couple. I'm born in a stable. I am the light that shines over my house is for everyone to see. I am here for everyone. And what do we do? Limit. Well, God only speaks to certain people. God is only for the wealthy and powerful and elite. God only comes to people like me. Where do we get that idea from? Practice, I guess. But it has nothing to do with this story. That's not what this is about. This story, these stories are about breaking that mold, about shattering that mold into thousands of little pieces so we never try to do it again. And yet we have. Oh, well, you know. I mean, I love the UCC. God is still speaking. But you know what we tend to think? Well, God's just speaking to us. Nobody else, none of those other people in any other denominations or any other faiths or other parts of the world, just, you know, it's great God is still speaking, and thank God God's still speaking to us. Yeah, God's still speaking to us. And you know what? To everybody else. There's no limits here, and there never has been. It doesn't matter. Doesn't matter if you're rich or poor. Doesn't matter if you're, you know, out on a hill somewhere or you're at the academy somewhere. Doesn't matter if you're in a nice, beautiful church sanctuary or you're in the stable. It doesn't matter. And that's what God was trying to get across to us. I have come into the world just like everybody else because I want everyone to make a connection. I want to make a connection with everyone. And my light is for everyone. We burn the greens on Epiphany to remind us of light and the light that shone. And the star that these wise people follow. And that that light is for everyone. So as we participate in the burning of the greens, or if we stand in fellowship hall and kind of watch out the doors, which is totally understandable in this kind of weather, let us imagine that that light truly is for all people. And that the light that we have within us is not to be hoarded or kept to ourselves, but to be shared. And the light that we possess as a congregation is not to be limited to ourselves, but is to be shared in this near part of the world that we live in and all around the world, because that is what God has intended it. It always has been true, and it always will be. Amen.